I would say it's easily in a million lines.
Yes. A million lines of code?
Absolutely. The algorithm is meant to indicate all of the different methods we use to decide which search results we're going to show you and in what order, or which recommendations we're going to choose for you. I think people, when they refer to the algorithm, they mean all the code that we've written to do those things. I don't think of it as one thing. I think of it as lots of little pieces that are trying to accomplish the overall goal of connecting you with what you're looking for or what we think you might want to watch.
There's not like a piece of code hidden in a safe or something.
There's no piece of code hidden in a safe. There's a lot of code, and it's scattered all over the place in our code base. If you look closely at it, it'll resemble much more accounting than any sort of dark, sophisticated thing.
There is, whether it's the algorithm or whatever it is, there is a degree of secrecy, isn't there, for good or bad reasons? I mean, you can't be completely open about all of this, can you? Or you're not open about all of it, it seems. Can you? Is that a fair comment?
Well, I mean, I think we're quite open about what we're trying to achieve. And I think we're open about the instances where we know it's not working and we think it could be better. I tend to be a little bit more reticent to discuss exactly how we're doing it. And there's a few reasons. First of all, we don't want people to try to game what we're doing. And sadly, we do see that on YouTube. And so everything we do, we have to think about the opportunities for gaming it. I mean, we're using certain kinds of information to help people find the videos they're looking for. That depends on that being that information coming from sincere viewers who were actually looking for things. Now, if instead it came from a robot that wasn't really looking for anything, it was just trying to make sure that a particular video showed up at the top of some search results or, you know, had a tremendous number of views, then we can't use that anymore. And so it's not just that there's a few more instances of poor search results or inflated view counts, but it's worse than that, because actually that means that we can't use the thing that we were using anymore. And so now we have to, you know, we have to take that away as a possibility for helping associate the viewers with the videos they want to watch and then move on to the next thing. And then, of course, that thing may also be abused. And so, you know, we have to try to protect these signals, as we call them, so that we don't lose them. And you know, and then we're left with very little to actually go on. I don't want to lock us into a particular way of doing things. You know, say for instance that 5 years ago, ranking the search results by the view count may have been a great thing to do. And that was because at that time, view count was one of the best signals that you could find for what are the quality of the video. Well, since then we've found other things that are even better. And we don't want people to become upset when they say, hey, wait a minute, these videos aren't ranked in the order of the view count. That's wrong. What's not wrong, because we, like I said, we would have done an experiment to find that there was actually a better way to do it. Yes, we take view count into account, but there's some other thing that we might want to do. For instance, a very good example is, if it were just ranked by view count, you'd never see any new videos. So you type plane crash after a plane crashes, and you'd see the oldest plane crash footage we have. If we want to have some video of the new incident, we can't rank everything by view count. We don't want to commit ourselves in a way to people thinking that this is the way it has to be and that we can't make any changes, because we have to. We have to make changes.
You mentioned view, I mean, view count is a very transparent signal because of the design of YouTube. Can you mention some of the other signals you're using?
Sure. One of those that we started using a couple of years ago now, I guess, was watch time. So what we noticed was that when people looked for videos, it was often the case that they would see one that looked like the video they wanted to watch, but then once they got on that watch page, it wasn't actually the video they were wanting to watch. Maybe it had a thumbnail that was, you know, very misleading, or a title that was particularly misleading. Now, fortunately, in most of those cases, eventually they got to the one they were looking for. And often that was because that would be somewhere on the related videos. But in looking at that situation, we thought, well, gee, that's kind of cr- crummy because why should I have to click two or three times in order to finally get to a video that I was looking for? We tried to figure out how to fix that. We thought, well, people tend to know fairly quickly whether or not the video they've landed on is the one they're looking for. The best example I remember of this was we saw one where there were several videos that had titles about a particular boxing match. And one of them, especially, had a thumbnail of a guy, like, he was just about to be hit and his, you know, his fist was right up in the other guy's face. And everybody was going to click on that one. Well, it turned out that the video behind that was a person talking about the fight. And it had no footage of the fight. And eventually the viewers would finally get to the one that had some footage of the fight. When we looked into that situation, we realized that one way to detect the difference between these was one of these videos wasn't getting watched very much, and the other one was.
Or watched for very long.
Or watched for very long, exactly. One of them wasn't getting watched very long, and the other one was. And so instead of just ranking the videos by how often they were clicked in response to a query, we ranked them for how much they were watched in response to a query. And so that helped that situation quite a bit.
How often are you twiddling the dials and refining this and tweaking this? Is this like a daily thing with little things that can change? Or is it like a once a year big implementation?
We've always got at least, 10 different changes that we're working on. And they may take somewhere between a few weeks to several months to finally launch. And there's usually some analysis and intuition, and then there's some implementation, some changes that you're gonna make to the code, and then there's lots of experimentation and evaluation in order to confirm that this change actually benefits the viewers. And so how many times do we do it a year? Maybe 50 times a year or 100 times a year.
Are there things that, levers that can be pulled, like, okay, today we're going to put 21% emphasis on watch time, and no, it needs to be 19%? Is it like that or not?
It's not really like that, because all of those settings or levers or all the code that we've written to make those kinds of decisions has been tuned based on evaluation and analysis of some kinds of experiments or other ways we have of rating changes. And so it wouldn't make sense for us to walk in and say, I'm feeling like we ought to put a higher weight on something. Even if I were to feel that we ought to put a higher weight on watch time, for instance, what that would amount to is some of the engineers doing several weeks worth of experiments to see whether or not putting a higher weight on watch time resulted in more people getting to the videos they watch faster.
We can see the data that we've got. Now, the data that we get back is completely random. It depends where, when the server received that message, it put it in its own computer's memory. So this time when we've run it, it's actually given us some useful information.
Because you've demonstrated some evidence in the broader subject. Another way that we might find to recommend things to you.